Hey guys, it's Tom Higginson from the band Plain White Tees, and this is I Effin' Love That Song podcast. Each week, I'll have an amazing songwriter join as a special guest to discuss their stories behind some of your favorite hit songs.
Hanging out here today with Johnny Resnick from the Goo Goo Dolls. He has written so many incredible songs, so many that I even, when I was going through your Spotify, was like, holy shit, I forgot about this song. You have just hit after hit after hit. Broadway, Long Way Down, love that song. Black Balloon, Slide. Almost wanted to talk to you about Name because I love that song.
Oh, but, I love that song.
I mean, I love all these songs, but
thank you very much.
But the song Iris, I fucking love that song. Let's talk a little bit about Iris. I know we were already talking a little bit about it and how that song, you know, that's your Delilah, if you will, the song that got so big that I feel like, I don't know about you, but I feel like I'm still living somewhat in the shadows of Delilah. Like Delilah is
bigger. Yeah.
So tell me a little bit about just where did that song, I know it was in the movie City of Angels.
Yeah.
Was that written for the movie or did that just kind of happen to be a song that you, that worked for the movie?
I wrote it for a film, the City of Angels soundtrack, which was like, I wasn't a big fan of the movie, but I love Wings of Desire and it's basically the same movie.
I think the song was actually bigger than the movie as well.
But I thought it was going to be really, really cool to be on a soundtrack with Peter Gabriel and Alanis. And, you know, I think U2 was in there too.
I was cool.
Just like, so we were very much the dark horse. You know, and I was like, oh, no, no, no. I want to be in that company because maybe someone will notice us, huh. You know, because I mean, right. We had already had a hit with Name, but to be honest with you, we would play shows and we would save Name until last, because as soon as we played that song, after we finished that song, everybody would leave, you know, because we were just banging sure. out punk rock songs. So then I saw the movie and I went back to my hotel room and I just worked on it. It came to me very quickly. And I always felt like the circumstances that I was living under at the time had a lot to do with that song, because I was in the middle of a divorce, my only divorce, hopefully. And I had left my hometown and I was living in a hotel in Los Angeles. You know, I was just starting a relationship with somebody else. And it was, you know, when you just start falling in love with somebody, I feel like I become hyper aware, kind of get this hyper empathetic kind of thing. Like you're, all your senses and your antenna are up because you're so stimulated by this new person in your life that you're very excited to be sharing time with. And then I saw the movie and I thought to myself, okay, if I was that guy, what would I say to this person who I just love more than anything, you know? And then I sat and I kind of talked it out, you know? It's like, what would I say to this girl? What would I say? It's like, I'm immortal. I don't feel the pain of being human. And I will live, or not live, but I will be around forever. And then he's willing to transcend all that, give all that, you know, immortality or whatever up, just to feel what it's like to, you know, be human, I guess. And being human, you know, let's face it, I mean, it's cool, but it sucks a lot of the times. I mean, we're so vulnerable and we're so fragile, no matter how hard we try to make ourselves. Well, the world is cruel as a whole, but as individuals, we're all pretty vulnerable, I think. You know, it's just being able to tap into that thing. But I think it was where I was at in my life that really kind of brought that song out of me. I was very sensitive to a love story at that point in my life.
Yeah. Nice. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's interesting that you saw the movie and then wrote it. Thinking about the movie, it sounds like it's very, very personal. Like I wouldn't have thought you had written it thinking about the movie at all. Like it sounds like it's very from the heart.
Oh, it was. I mean, like I said, I was beginning a relationship with somebody else and I remember playing it for her and I made her turn her back to me. You know, it was very strange, you know.
Is that the first time, the first person that had ever heard the song was
yeah,
her?
Yeah. And I played it for her and we were sitting in this hotel room and I just remember just saying, you know, you got to turn your back to me. I can't do this if you're looking at me.
What was her reaction?
She kind of sealed the deal.
Yeah. Okay. Good.
But it was very emotional for me to share something like that, because I'd never written a song like that, and because we start as like a garage band, you know, mm-hmm. just bashing out three chords and, you know, kind of poppy but real loud, you know, like you guys. It's like,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
You know, very much the same kind of pedigree. Then we went into the studio to record it, and I had written that bridge or whatever you want, da 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 da, whatever that part of the song would be called. And I thought it was really cool. And then Rob Cavallo, who's producing it, said, well, okay, let's put some strings on it. And Robbie and I were terrified to do that, because we were sure that everybody was just going to hate us after that. Everybody that liked our band was going to hate it. But then we were sitting in front of the glass in the control room, and we were watching the guys play it. And Robbie and I looked at each other, and I'm like, you know what? We're turning a corner, and there's no coming back. So are we going to do this or not? And we were like, fuck it, let's do it. And
Yeah,
it turned out to be the right move. Yeah.
I think so, yeah. Name obviously feels a lot like in the same vein as Iris. Was the success, did that kind of help you be, okay, we did that kind of weird, softer, you know, different thing for us for that song, and people loved it. Was that kind of like gave you a little bit of that freedom to say, fuck it, and be like, you know what? Name was a different thing for us and it worked. Maybe we just go for it.
I mean, you know, no, I don't think that was a factor. I mean, because that song too, I couldn't believe how much shit we got for Name, you know? And yeah, we got a lot of shit from people about that song. Like, oh, you guys sold out, song. You know, that's
I love that song.
It worked out really well for us, you know, and I had always written kind of ballady things, and however primitive they were, you know, you got to think about, does it fit? Is it appropriate? Does the suit fit? And sure, it fit. So I'm going to wear it. And, you know, I have to kind of forget about the audience or my friends or my family or my wife or whatever, what they're going to think about what I do. You know, I don't share my material with anybody until it's done, you know. Just the people who are immediately involved in it. It kind of drives my wife crazy, because I get like, I don't want your opinion. I feel like I'm setting people up, like, you love me or you like me, we're friends or whatever, or you're my girl, you know. I don't want to put you on the spot. If you hate this song, you're not going to go, I hate this. Although she does say, I don't like that, I don't like that song. And I'm like, okay, you don't like that song, okay. You know, I just feel like I should be sure enough of myself to not need other people's approval. But I see, and this is where I get weirdly psychological about things, because I truly believe one of the things that drove me, and I can't speak for anybody else, that drove me to work really hard and try to be as creative and try to be successful and put your heart on your sleeves and take the risk of doing the work, is because I wanted people to like me. I wanted approval. Of course you want approval. You want everyone to love your band. But it was a situation where, you know, I mean, I grew up in a very fucked up situation, and I always felt like an outsider no matter where I was. Like, I mean, the day I was born, I was in my house. I obviously don't remember this, but I grew up in a house full of women. It was all women and me.
Huh.
I was never going to be a part of the club. I was never going to be as tight as they were going to be, and still are today. Like, all my sisters are still, you know, and I show up and it's like, oh, I'm sticking out. I'm the sore thumb. So it's like, it's wanting to have a feeling of belonging, you know?
Yeah. That's very cool of you to acknowledge that, because I feel like when I think back to our career and when we were on a major label and everything, it was very much that same sense of, okay, wanting to be liked, wanting to be approved of. Mm-hmm. And now I think maybe the success has afforded me a little bit of a who cares attitude.
And having a little financial cushion never hurts, you know?
Yeah, and not in a bad way. I love all of our fans. I love being liked, of course, but
yeah.
But I definitely feel like I was a little bit more self-aware of that aspect of it. before. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's what is drove us to, like you said, work so hard and write those songs.
I mean, I can't speak to anybody else, speak about anybody else, but at least in my case, I think part of it was that it's also the way you and I are wired. We're just wired to do this. Whether we were able to make a living doing it or not, we would still pick up a guitar every day or sit down at a piano every day because it's just the way you're wired.
For sure. For me, just because I love songs. Like I'll hear some song on the radio that has nothing to do with me or a song I would write, but I'd be like, oh, damn, that was so cool. And I wouldn't try to write that, but that would inspire me to just grab that guitar and like do something. Creativity sparks more creativity, I feel like.
I think it's contagious when you, like I started putting, I'm in writing mode now, so I listen to a lot of music because creativity is infectious. You know?
Yeah, absolutely.
And you start listening to all these great songs and old stuff and new stuff. There's some really great bands out there now. You know, there's always good music. It's just at certain times in history, you have to dig a little deeper to find it.
Tell me about Fearless. Super catchy, fun song. Yeah, it's a little bit different than some of your hits, but I feel like, you know, we have that same problem with like, man, you know, I'm kind of thinking like, fuck it, we just make an acoustic album next because we have this success with these acoustic songs. Yeah. And of course the band, much like you guys, you start out a lot harder. We were like a pop punk band when we started. Mm-hmm. And it's like, we're always trying to kind of reconnect with the rock stuff.
Yeah.
But in reality, it's always people just connect with whatever it is about those acoustic songs. You guys are probably just going through the same thing where, man, you want to be, you know, in writing songs, it's just, it's fun and you get super stoked sometimes about certain things that maybe aren't exactly what the audience expects or what the audience wants. But at the same time, you got to be enjoying it yourself too. So I was just kind of listening to Fearless. That felt like that to me. It's like, man, I can picture Johnny writing this song, having fun, the band, it's a fun song, got to be great to play live. So it's like, who cares if it doesn't fit in the, you know, the so-called mold of what people think of Goo Goo Dolls, you know, it's like, you just gotta have fun with it.
This is always a problem for me. I don't know about you, but it's always a problem for me. It's like, I feel like I can't write a song with the audience really in mind. I want everybody to love what I do. We all do. We all want people to love what we do. I think sometimes I have to throw my hands up in the air and just go, this is where I'm at. And
totally.
If you get it, great. If you don't, okay. But if I got to write a Goo Goo Doll song, or you get the thing from industry people, they're kind of like, why can't you write another song like Iris or Sly? It's like, if I could do that, don't you think I would? It's like,
right.
But
I'm trying. It's like, I just wrote this great song and it might not sound exactly like Iris or Name or Slide, but it's kick-ass still, you know? I feel your pain.
I mean, but you have to find where your heart and your head are at, you know? I mean, I have to find where my heart and my head are at the time and, like, really get into that situation, you know? And it's scary sometimes because I don't know if you feel this way. Sometimes I feel like, well, did we build an entire career on one song, you know? It was just sort of like that song was so big, and I know that you've had the same thing happen to you guys, where it's just, you just have this song that's just so iconic and it becomes, it's an evergreen song. You're lucky. Most guys who do what we do never get a song that will always be played. And you guys have one of those, you know, you get at least one. It always feels like everything is going to be a letdown after something like that. I'm such a people pleaser. I know this is going to let you down, but here's my new song. Yeah.
Sure. No, that's a great way of putting it. It got so big that it transcended the band. It transcended everything you've ever done.
Yeah.
So it's like, how the hell do you even come close to that again?
I guess you just don't try. You can't consciously sit there and scheme to beat it. It was funny because we were just talking about the Bruce Springsteen record, Nebraska, which was very, and I don't know when that record falls in line after Born in the USA. I don't know if it was the one after it. Do you?
I want to say it was the one right before it, actually.
before.
I might be wrong, but I'm pretty sure it was right before Born in the USA.
Oh, wait, hold on. I got the research department looking it up
here. Oh, there we go.
Well, while he's looking that up, let's talk about us.
So what were you going to say about Nebraska, though? I love Bruce Springsteen.
Well, yeah, me too. It came what?
Before.
Came before. Okay. It came before.
So that's what I thought, yeah.
And that, you know,
and they couldn't be more polar opposites of albums, those two.
No, you know? But I felt like that record was him kind of taking a step back from this mega spotlight that he was in. I mean, you know, such a big rock star. And then really you take a huge risk and put out this very solemn record. And it's beautiful. It's just Springsteen's so good.
This is something that I always think about. And I don't know if this is sensitive, subject matter, but do you think it has anything to do with Bruce Springsteen being a solo artist? With being a solo artist, do you have a little bit more maybe liberties to like, oh, I'm going to do an acoustic record and who gives a shit? Because then my next one's going to be an arena rock record. And is there something like that, you think?
I think the world is a different place now. But yeah, I think when you're a solo artist, that he's the boss, you know, so yeah. He can do whatever he wants. And it's interesting, you know, when you hear a song like Streets of Philadelphia or whatever, it's a little bit, to me, it sounded like he was experimenting a little bit. But forget about Springsteen. Like Tom Petty had these very distinct periods in his career where he worked, the Damn the Torpedoes stuff, and then the stuff that he did with Dave Stewart, and then the stuff he did with Jeff Lynne, and then the stuff that he did with Rick Rubin, and a lot of it is different. And the Dave Stewart stuff, you know, Don't Come Around Here No More, that, you know, it's very like using drum machines and synths and all this stuff. Pre-internet, I think the world had a much longer attention span.
You know? Sure, a little more accepting of artists being artists and experimenting a little bit, maybe.
Yeah, I mean, you weren't about to get your head hacked off by the label if you sold 10 records less, you know.
Right, right.
And whenever I, you know, I'm not blowing smoke, but every time I hear Delilah, I'm just, wherever I am, it always makes me take pause because it's such a perfectly written song. You know, it is. And it's like you were saying, it's one of those things. It's like you can feel the heart in it. You know, you can tell that that comes from the deepest part of where you draw. People can tell that. And that's why that song will, that's why that song will always be played. I love that. It's a good feeling. We already won the game, bro.
Right, exactly. It's all gravy from here, you know? But, you know, it's like, I'm sure with you, with Iris, it's like there wasn't any special mojo or anything you did differently for that one. You know, it was the same thing. Maybe, like you said, the movie maybe inspired a little bit of a direction, but, I mean, it's like with Delilah, I don't know if you know the story, real quick version. Met this girl, gave her my album. She loved it. I told her I had a song about her, which was a lie. She kept asking me, you know, oh, where's my song? When do I get to hear my song? Like, shit, I guess I better write this girl a song. And that's just the song that came out. But again, maybe it was a little, you know, kick in the ass to actually do it or something. I don't know. Like you seen the movie or, but
yeah, I think women drive you. Women are always the muse. It's always a woman. There's always a woman involved somehow.
The songs are about girls for the most part. Why aren't they all hit? You know, it's like, what was it about that one song or that one day where, like, what was I thinking right before I thought of those lyrics? Or, you know,
I don't know. Those are the kind of moments that you really have to become aware of. You always have to be vigilant. I'm sure you do this because every songwriter I've ever talked to, they're always talking about, they have the little recorder and you're in the shower and you got soap in your eyes and you're just like, oh my God, I don't want to forget this. I gotta hum this into the phone. And then you get someplace where you can listen to it and it's total shit.
Oh, but, always.
But yeah. You're just collecting these ideas. The thing I want to know about Delilah is, was it a quick just come to you song or did it take some effort?
So I didn't know the girl really at all. I knew that she was a friend of a friend and we hung out one night because the next day she was going back to school in New York and she was, you know, super beautiful, and that's pretty much, that was it. So that's all I had to work from. To answer your question, the very first, I also had the guitar riff was kind of there. I think I was trying to learn a Red Hot Chili Peppers song, and I completely like fucked up and hit a wrong chord and was like, ooh, that sounds kind of cool.
Wow.
And I had this guitar part that I was like, oh, you know, I could listen to this for like 3 minutes. If you get something like that where it's like, okay, already the bed is good, then you just kind of have to add to it without fucking it up, you know?
Right.
So basically I had this little guitar thing kicking around. And when I finally got pressured enough from Delilah to write this song about her, it was like, oh, maybe I should try something with that little guitar part. I swear to God, dude, I started playing it and the fucking song, the first verse and the, oh, it's what you do to me, it was just fucking came out of my mouth.
Yeah. Like, but it's like, you're channeling it. It's like you start to lose control. Like the song starts to lead you, which
right.
is which
oh,
is
yeah.
really awesome. And that's kind of, yeah, kind of how it worked with Iris too.
Nice.
That song,
yeah.
It was like pulling me, you know, and that felt good because it didn't take too much crazy sitting there for a week going, you know, what's the chord change? What's, you know,
I will say that that first verse and chorus was instantaneous, written within, you know, 6 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
But because that was all I actually knew about Delilah, the rest of the song, I kind of had to like, oh shit, now what do I say? You know,
yeah.
I took about 6 months or so, just like you said, in the shower, what would be like a cool second verse, or, you know, like
taking
my time to make sure that, because I thought like, damn, this is actually pretty fucking good, this first verse.
Uh-huh.
So I wanted to make sure everything was as good, you know, as that beginning. So,
you're lucky you got to meet a girl named Delilah, though. I just have to say that, because if her name was Gladys, it wouldn't have worked.
Almost every song I write is about a girl, but yeah. I don't normally put the girl's name in the song, but Delilah, yeah. I was like, fuck, I've got to use that. You know, I've got to put that in the song, right?
Great name. Do you know where Delilah is now?
I haven't talked to her in probably about a year. Last thing I heard, she was in Philadelphia. She was like an Olympic, made it to like the qualifying rounds of the Olympics.
Wow.
For like the steeplechase.
Wow.
Which is like a long distance, the hurdle thing where they jump over the hurdle and then there's like that puddle of water behind it.
On a horse? Is that on a horse? Or, okay. Oh, I get.
That's probably why they call it that. It's probably originated at that or something.
Wow. Yeah. You should just call her and thank her.
Yeah.
Call and say thanks.
Maybe I will.
Nah, don't bother.
Yeah. Hey, what is the deal? This is very odd for any hit song, like, period. But A, the song is like kind of a waltz, right? It's like, is it 3-3 or is it?
6-8-3-4. It's a waltz.
Okay. Oh, yes, I meant 3-4.
Yeah.
But the intro and, you know, the little reintro after the chorus is a different time signature.
It goes from 6-8 to 4-4. I don't know how it worked. I don't know how that happened. To his credit, the guy who was playing drums with us at the time, you know, figured it out. Somehow he figured it out. He's like, I got to go from 6-8 to 4-4. Sort of like, all right.
You wrote it like that without even really...
I didn't even realize I was doing it. You know,
huh.
It was very weird. It was strange.
Once again, it works great, you know?
Yeah.
But you just don't usually see that in my hit song. You know, it's a very unique thing to hear like that on the radio or in a hit. It's really cool.
Yeah. You know, I mean, I look at that song now and I'm like, would that song be a hit now? I don't know. I don't know.
I mean, but, I think so, dude.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. The world is very different now than when that song came out. It was right at the beginning of the internet piracy thing. But I've had so much fun. And that song, what I love about that song is I really still love playing it for people. And I love the fact that I enjoy playing that song because I know a few rock star guys who are very resentful of their biggest success. I understand we're all artists and we want everybody to love everything we do, but I always felt it was sort of arrogant to, and I know guys who do this, is they won't play their biggest hit, or they rework it into some bizarre thing, you know, and I feel like, wow, man, you know, some guy and his girlfriend just paid like $150 or $200 to come and see you play. You're not going to give them that. Like,
right.
That's a lot of balls, man. You know, but you know, I mean, I love people. I love the audience. I love our audience. I love when they come out. I love when they sing. I love recognizing people. And I'm sure you guys have the same thing. You know, it's like you have these fans that come to 10 shows during your tour and you're like, wow, wow, this is, I wouldn't come see his tent.
Totally. And I feel like there's almost like that song got me here. So it's almost like out of respect for the fucking song.
Oh, yeah.
Play it the way, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. Like, obviously, like I said, I'm such a fan of songs. You have to honor that song. You know, the melodies you sing and the words you sing connected, which is what we all want in the end, is to connect with an audience. So when it does, yeah, I never understood that either. Like, you know, it's like if something clicks, man, you should be grateful. Like I said, kind of like honor it.
I think so. You know, gratitude. Listen, one thing that I've learned, you know, over the last 20 years or whatever, is that gratitude cancels all the bad shit. It's like when I'm bitching and moaning about my life, it's like, no. Let's count what we're grateful for.
Right.
And and that diffuses that evil little bomb in my head, you know, that's about to go off, and then I go into self-destruct mode and treat everybody like shit. And like my life is amazing.
Right. I think gratitude is the key to happiness. You know, it doesn't matter if you live in a beautiful big ass house or a one bedroom apartment. If you wake up every day and say like, ah, oh, thank you for this place I live. Thank you for this day. Your day is going to be good no matter what.
Yes. Yeah. No, it's very true. I have a 3-year-old daughter and she taught me a really cool lesson, you know, because I'm like, I go away a lot and I come home, and every time I come home, I have to bring her a surprise. So one time I saw this little set of dolls or something, and I thought it'd be great. I'm going to bring this home for Lily. She's going to love it. She's like, Daddy, what did you bring me? I took it out from behind my back and I'm like, I brought you these dolls. And she just kind of looked at them and looked at me and she's like, I don't like those. And I said, well, what would you like? And she said, do you have any Swedish fish? And I was just like, I mean, it's like, yeah, man, it's not about the money or any of that. It's about the connection and the love. And she humbled me in that moment because I couldn't buy her love.
Sure.
She just wanted a little piece of candy. You know?
I like that. I mean, I have a son as well. And yeah, it's like same thing. I'd always try to bring him home just something, you know, whether it was, like you said, some kind of doll or, but of course, candy is always good too. No matter what you give them, it's not going to compare to you just being there. You know, like you being home, that time with them, either that or their iPad. It's a toss.
Yeah, I'm trying so hard, you know, like limiting it. But you know what? This should be a show. And you and I should both host this where you just bring on every musician and talk to them about what their life was before they had kids and then what their life was like after they had kids. And just the meanest metal guys in bands.
Oh, yeah.
Like, yeah, we used to have an orgy every night and worship Satan. Now I'm changing diapers. It would be amazing. It would be. I think that would be a lot of fun. You give parenting advice to musicians.
Yeah, from the least likely to give the advice, you know.
Don't smoke pot in front of your 3-year-old.
I love being a dad, though. Growing up, I was like, I always wanted to have kids. You know, I never, I guess, made plans for it or never expected it to happen. But man, it's just a life changer. And I feel very lucky that we had our success, you know, before that, so that I did have, like you said, like a little bit of that cushion. You know, I wasn't having to claw my way and struggle and figure things out. So I can just really just be with my son and just enjoy life with him. And you know, dive in without having to be too distracted by figuring out how to pay the bills and stuff. So
yeah, I mean, my wife and I waited a long time to have a kid, and I waited before. I never thought I would have a kid. In some ways, I'm really glad that I waited. I think I could have done it 10 years earlier, but it happened at the right time, and you know, it's amazing.
3 years mm-hmm. old, you're right in the thick of it. That's a crazy, crazy time right there.
It's like schizophrenic. It's unbelievable. It's like she's 60 people in 5 minutes.
For sure. Like a different person every, like you leave to go play a one-off, you come home, you're like, who the hell are you? You're a different person.
Yeah. How old is your son?
He's 10.
Wow. So that's cool because you guys get to be buddies.
Oh, totally cool. Like he's in the next room. He's playing some video game. I don't know what he's playing tonight. He's got like his buddies that he goes online with and they all just play video games. And I feel like, okay, Lennon, let's take a walk. His name is Lennon too, by the way. Like John Lennon. Yeah.
Okay.
But yeah, just even to pry him off to like do anything sometimes. It's like summertime. He's on there with his friends. So, you know, I remember summers as a kid. So you got to let him do his thing.
Absolutely.
Like I said, I'm just finally, like you, finally starting to get inspired to be creative again and start writing again, which is, it feels amazing. So yeah, I mean, I think like the world's going to kind of dictate where we go from here and what's next and when we get to play shows again and tour again and everything. But until then, being creative, I think, is really important. And, you know, making some cool music and just staying positive. I think being creative for me definitely helps my positivity, you know. Even if it's a shitty song, I feel like, that was cool. Like I made something that didn't exist 20 minutes ago, you know.
Yeah, that's one of the things that I find interesting about, you know, anybody who has a creative outlet, painting, writing, singing, dancing, whatever. It's like you never have an excuse to be bored because you can always go to your outlet and express it and exhaust yourself with it.
Absolutely.
And then come out the other side. And yeah, the world will ultimately be a little bit better because you exercised what you were given, you know?
Yeah. And the beauty of it is the more you do that and the more you do tap in, you know, the better chance you have of really striking something that does.
Oh, happen. Yeah. I don't get me wrong. I mean, there are days where I literally, and it was someone described it to me because I was like, I called a friend of mine who's an incredible songwriter. And I said, dude, I don't know how to write a song. How the hell do we write songs? And he's like, I don't know. I have no idea. He's like, you just sit and he goes, some days it's like you're at like a festival and you just dropped your wedding ring into the Port-a-John and you got to dig it out of there. It's a very graphic description of,
you know, great.
Rooting around in the shit, trying to find something good. But yeah, you know, and then other days it's easy. It reflects life in a lot of ways. Some days are just way better than others. You know?
For sure. Well, I got to ask the biggest question, which you probably Google it pretty easily, but the name Iris, one of those weird songs that it doesn't say the name anywhere in the song. Now that I know the story, was it the girlfriend that you were with at the time, her name or anything?
No, but that was in the time where like Billy Corgan did that a lot where he'd be like, why did you call that song Bullet with Butterfly? Whatever. Okay. Just
sure.
It was just, I didn't have a name for the song because I'm very bad at naming, putting a title other than whatever's in the hook. So I didn't have anything. And I was looking through an LA Weekly and Iris Dement was doing a show and I needed to have a name. And I was like, Iris, that's a beautiful name. I'll just call the song Iris. Really?
No shit. Wow.
I wish I had a better story. You know, it's like break your nose. Yeah, I kicked this guy's ass, but he kicked me in the face before. But no, I got drunk and I walked into a wall.
Right. I like that story, man. Sometimes, you know, it's like, that's a perfect name for that song. If that song was called Want You to Know Who I Am, would that have been a fucking hit? Well, that's not, doesn't sound as good. It's not as catchy. I don't know.
That's true. I mean, you know, it was just one of those times and, you know, we're lucky to have experienced where just all the planets line up or like, you know, I just love to keep making analogies about it. But, you know, the pitch comes over the plate and you're just watching the ball get smaller and just go over the fence. It's just, you know, just feels so effortless.
Oh, yeah. Let me ask you this. As an artist, because a lot of the people that I've talked to are like the songwriters, but as like a fellow artist, I was just telling somebody recently because they were asking about Delilah and like that time. Oh, that must have been so cool. The song was blowing up and everything. But honestly, for us, when that song was like a hit, we have never worked harder in our lives.
Oh, yeah.
Doing 5 radio stations a day, going to do a sound check party, going to do a show, getting on a red-eye flight, flying for 3 hours, sleeping on the plane, landing, going to the next radio station. Did you guys, for Iris, was it hitting it that hard, or did that do a little bit more of the work for you?
I mean, what it did was it opened so many doors that were closed to us that we were like, look, you know, and we were told by our manager, he's like, look, you have the ball. And he's like, keep your head down and just work your ass off and just keep going. Don't stop. Keep going. Do everything you can. And same situation. It's like, you know, the harder I work, the luckier I get. Very much like that. So, you know, there was no gig that was beneath us. So we would do anything. I mean, I got dropped onto a glacier by a helicopter to play the song. And then, you know, I played in a volcano and it started to rain. And
holy shit.
You know, just playing on a mountain, freezing my ass off. When you're at it for so long and then you finally get the opportunity, it was put to us very plainly. It's like people can forget you so quickly. And if you don't put in the time, you're not going to have anything that lasts, you know? So that's the moral of the story, I guess, right?
I've never heard that before, what you just said. The harder I work, the luckier I get.
Yeah.
That is fucking genius. And that's the truth of it.
It's very Buffalo of me to say that.
It's like a perfect way of putting it because it's so true. Love that. I'm going to steal that. Thank you.
Absolutely. I'm not the first guy that said that.
Well, cool, man. Thanks again for doing this.
Yeah, this was great,
taking
man.
Time out.
You know, good luck to you and stay safe and healthy. Enjoy that son of yours. And you come on do my show. Okay.
Done deal. Hell yeah.
All right. That would be amazing. I would love that. And I will see you back out there on the road.
Can't wait. Yeah. Dude, let's tour again. That was amazing.
I would love to. Thank you so much, man. All right.
Good to see you.
Good to see you. Have a great night.